This is a day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God's blessings on our worship this morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Rejoice, friends of God. Come into his presence and celebrate the new life God has given you. The end of another year compels us to look back on it and carry its joys and blessings forward into the new year.
Thank you, Lord, for the goodness you have shown us in the year
now. You have blessed us in ways tremendous power, and in ways we don't fully know or appreciate. Let us also look back one more time and unburden ourselves of all that destroys our happiness and hinders our mission. God has heard your confession. His love, mercy, and grace are everlasting. Therefore, hear the words of St. Paul recorded in the letter to the Romans. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Therefore, we will begin a new year forgiven by God as his redeemed saints. We forge ahead in hope that does not disappoint us. May God bless us and keep us in the coming year. Let us pray. Eternal Father, before whom all generations rise and fall, teach us to think earnestly on the brevity of our lives and on the immensity of your goodness. Help us to enter the new year trusting in the name of your Son and walking in the way of peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our first lesson from Romans 8, it begins at verse 31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one that condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any powers, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. From Psalm 90, and we'll read that responsively, and notice it has some divisions in it. From Psalm 90. O God, you have always been God.
Long before
the
earth was formed,
long after it ceases to exist. You have been, always will be. O God, you have always been God. Please rise for our gospel lesson. It's an ancient tradition, by the way, to do that. From Luke 13, and it's also on the screen. Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should I use up the soil?" So the man replied, "Leave it alone for one more year and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down." This is God's word. Please be seated and we'll continue with the next hymn. And to him who is and was and is to come be honor and power and glory both now and forevermore. Amen. The text for our consideration comes from Psalm 91. I'll be talking about Murphy's Law, and there's a good example. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Truly, he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in your hands, so you'll not strike your foot against a stone. You'll tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. This is God's word. In the name of our powerful and loving Lord, dear friends in Christ, does Murphy's Law work in your life or lives? And you know what I mean by Murphy's Law, right? When things can go wrong, they will go wrong. And then there's, of course, a corollary at the worst possible moment. And if I asked if anybody didn't have Murphy's Law working in their lives, I don't think any hands would go up. And if one did go up, I would probably be shocked. Wouldn't believe it, because it happens. Well, that's a good thought to think about as we're finishing up 2023 and looking into 2024. And a psalm helps us with that. It's telling us, stay in the Lord's shelter. But let's back up just a little bit. Murphy's Law is actually necessary. And of course, we don't know exactly what God is thinking unless he tells us. But there's this. I'm not perfect, not anywhere close. No one else is either. So if we lived in a perfect world where nothing ever broke, no stuff fell down from the ambo, everything perfect, then we would start to think that we're perfect too. And the Lord certainly knows that he can't allow that. So because we're imperfect, we live in an imperfect world. So God had to do that. But then because we live in such a world, and as we think about the end of 2023 and look forward to 2024, what God tells us, what God reminds us is, stay in the Lord's shelter. In Minnesota, it's cold and snow. Would you put up the desert, please? Okay. Here's a picture from the Psalm. Looks real inviting, right? Not. And consider David, wrote many psalms. At one point, King Saul was chasing David. trying to capture him and his life. So imagine 120 degrees in the shade. No water. And running away from that madman that's trying to end your life. Difficult. And you probably even wondered, will I be live tomorrow or tonight for that matter? And Getty, please. But then you're near the Dead Sea. And here's what you come across. Doesn't that look a lot more inviting than the desert that was before? So, a nice waterfall, pleasant, cool water, shade to be under. Well, that's one of the pictures that our psalm has for us, that God provides that for us. So that's part of God's shelter. So when it's hot and everything, really inviting. The shelter that God provides for us is inviting as well. And that shelter is God's Word that we get to enjoy in our worship this morning. It's the sacraments, baptism. We'll be having communion in a little bit. And those are God's shelter and God providing rest and help that we need. So something really inviting. And it's something that we need. Another picture from the psalm. It's of a fowler. We don't use that word very much. Somebody trying to catch birds. So that person catching birds will have some, well, bait out, maybe corn, worms for robins, you know, something like that. Then has a net ready and hides him or herself, and then wants to throw the net over the birds and capture them. But then picture a mother bird recognizing the trap and keeping her young birds from being captured by the fowler. That's a picture the psalm uses for us, and it's a thought of how God cares for us and the help that he provides. The devil likes to put lots of traps out for us, throws out lots and lots of bait. Can be, well, lots of different things that look attractive, and he wants to use them to separate us from God and to get us to sin and lead us further and further from God. The devil has allies to help him too. One is the world all around us. And the devil is bad enough all by himself. And then there's a third one. And one way, the third one might be the worst. And guess who the third one is? It's right in here. For each of us, the sinful part in us, inside us, an ally to the devil. So we need help. And that's exactly what God provides for us in His Word. He provides shelter. Or when we think about communion coming up in just a little bit, there, God reminds us, I've done this all for you. You are forgiven. You're getting the body and blood of Jesus. And it's God turning what looks real simple and in one way meaningless into something really valuable. Another picture the psalm provides for us. And with all the wars going on, we can get a little bit of thought of that. The picture is a war going on, battles, and great danger. But then, God provides protection. He provides His shelter. And we can think of those three enemies that I mentioned. If we didn't have help, those enemies for sure would conquer us. So God provides help. And He uses ways that look not all that valuable. His power is different than what our world recognizes as power. Muscle, guns, militaries, all that. God uses a little baby. God becomes human. And He comes to do what you and I can't do. So we can think about all the times that we listen to the devil when we shouldn't. Jesus didn't fail in that once. And we can think about who Jesus came to help. He didn't come to help somebody who's distinguished before God. And actually, there's no one distinguished before God. None. Nada. So God takes nothing and makes it something So he comes to aid people like you and me. So Jesus, part of God's program, is God, doesn't listen to the devil even once. So, never has to take a time out at home. Never has to sit in the naughty corner. Never fails. And so God takes the nothing that I have and you have and makes something. He gives us Jesus' perfect life. So in Jesus, as far as God's concerned, you and I have led a perfect life. He gives that to us. He punishes sin and has to. He wouldn't be God if he didn't. But he punishes Jesus. So makes a huge transfer, takes every sin from me and you, puts it on Jesus, and punishes Jesus in your and my place. So, a gift that God gives us. He's taking, which he is very good at, takes what looks like nothing and makes it something. He declares us God's people. All a gift. So, think about that gift. Treasure that gift. Stay in the shelter of that gift. One more picture that we'll think about this morning. God has some helpers to help you and me. In other words, God's angels, God's messengers. And when we think of that, we shouldn't think of, well, as depicted on TV, an angel come to help somebody, I don't know, get their confidence, you know, maybe better than some of the other television out there. But anyway, they're just there to help people feel better about themselves or get some things corrected. Okay? But in reality, God's angels are God's version of Army Rangers, Navy SEALs, whatever they call it for the Air Force or Marines or Air Corps. So the special forces, and those special forces are well-trained, very powerful, and they make the SEALs or Army Rangers or whatever look like nothing. So God uses those powerful angels to help you and me, to be allies for us, to bring us to God's shelter, to bring us to a pool of cool, pleasant water, nice shade. So that's good for us then as we think about 2023 and we think ahead to 2024. soul for 2023. God was there. He's removed all the times that we've blown it. And talk back to mom or dad or sinned in some other way. And there's plenty of that in all of our lives. That's all forgiven, all removed. What will 2024 bring? Don't know. But in one way, it's good we don't know. But we do know. Well, Murphy's Law is going to work in 2024 just as it did in 2023. It's going to be there. Things are going to break. And there's plenty of that in our development and just our house and the next house just recently. So we know stuff is going to happen, difficulties. But we know, and this is what's really important, God is there. He has forgiven us in Jesus. He gives us the shelter that we need and protection. As we head into 2024, we go in God's hands and we go in His protection. His power is there. So depend on that. Keep on using God's shelter. Keep on living in that shelter. That shelter won't fail us. Amen. Let's join in confessing our faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And an usher will bring the offering forward, please. Please rise for the response of prayer, and it'll show up there and in your bulletins as well. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever.
Every day I will praise you and exalt your name.
It is fitting, O Lord, as we think of the year now past, to express our gratitude for the countless gifts of grace we have received from you.
You have been faithful to your promises and loving toward all you have made.
You clothe your creation with beauty. You feed even the birds and tell us that we are much more valuable than they.
You know what we need, and you give us all good things.
Clothing and food, safety and health, possessions and money, even life itself. All these come to us from your generous hand.
Amen.
We thank you especially for your word and Holy Supper, which strengthen our faith, lead us from shield us from temptation, and equip us for service. Almighty and eternal God, you have been gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. As you lead your people, Israel, with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, so lead us by the light of your word, that we may live our lives to your glory and be prepared to die in your peace. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated and we'll sing the next two verses. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take, drink ye all of it. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The Lord's table is prepared. Come, eat this bread, drink this fruit of the vine. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
We'll continue with the third verse. Please step forward as directed by the ushers, and you'll start on the outside and then eventually in the middle here, so when you down the side, and then return by the second aisle from either side. May this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace, you are forgiven. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this Holy Supper. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, look on you with favor and give you peace. We'll continue with the closing hymn. And I didn't introduce myself before, but you've seen me here often enough, you probably should know who I am by now. I'm Pastor Smith, and anyway, several announcements. During the vacancy, all announcements for the bulletin or pre-service slides should be directed to Terry Borkhart. Did I pronounce that right? Okay. Reverend Chris Elke is the vacancy pastor. If you need a pastor's services, you should contact him using the contact information in the bulletin. And taking down the Christmas decorations around church will take place Saturday, this coming Saturday, January 6th at 9, and there was another... Sorry, one more item. The January Forward in Christ is available out in the narthex, and I'll be out there greeting people, so anyway, and also welcome if any of you are guests in our service this morning, introduce yourself to me, and anyway, glad you could be here, and hope you can come again. Oh, and thanks to the Kreuter family for working with me there, and Katie as well. Thank you. Thank you.
Blessed be your. Oops, there we go.